Merhaba, sen de gel. Ahlan ve sahlan bikum. Ahlan ve sahlan bikum. Fi thalith umsiya sharia. Li merkez Sultan Qaboos al-Thaqafi lil-Thaqafa fi hadhihi al-sana. We are delighted to have you all with us this evening, and I see a lot of new faces, and that makes me happy. Before I introduce our guest speaker, I would like to announce the upcoming events. The next upcoming event is next week on Tuesday the 5th, we have screening of Sons of Sinbad at 6 o'clock. The last Sultan Pose event will be November 13th with Dr. Emily Drumstead, and she's going to present Revolt Against the Sun for Nazif and Malaika. And our last event for this year will be Celebration of Arabic Language Day on December 10th. So I look forward to seeing you all in all of these events. We are delighted to have with us Dr. Levi Thompson this evening. He is a professor, assistant professor at the University of Colorado Boulder. He teaches courses in modern Middle Eastern literatures and cultures. Dr. Thompson is currently working on a book tentatively titled Reorienting Modernism, Imagining a Modernist Geography Across Arabic and Persian Poetry. He will present to us Bekir Shaker Sayyad from The Rain Song in Shudat al-Matar. Without further ado, join me in welcoming Dr. Levi Thompson.
To be here, and I'm also thrilled to see the size of this audience. This is amazing. I'm absolutely just so happy to see so many people here to hear me speak about what is possibly my most favorite modern Arabic poem, which is Shudat al-Matar, The Rain Song, by the Iraqi poet Bekir Shaker Sayyad. Likewise, I'm so happy to see some familiar faces, new faces as well. I'm just so pleased that all of you decided to come out this evening to hear a little bit about this poem. And I'd also like to thank the Sultan Qaboos Cultural Center for inviting me here. They've been wonderful hosts. I've had a great trip. I'm missing something like 2 feet, 2 new feet of snow in Colorado since I left. They canceled my classes today, so I didn't actually miss anything. Nice. and also a special thank you to Abia for helping me out with all the reservations, arrangements, everything being such a priceless. Thanks, Abia. So my name is Levi Thompson, and I've been studying Arabic and Arabic poetry for several years, maybe around a decade now or more. Well, the poetry for about a decade. Is that right? Okay. I'll speak closer. There we go. And I'm currently working on a book about the modernist poetic movement, not just in Arabic, but also in Persian. So it's a comparative study in which I'm trying to show where poetry from the Arab world and Iran fits within the broader movement of modernism. So we're thinking about global modernism or planetary modernism, things like that. And with this project, I'm hoping to also challenge a few standard conceptions about what world literature is and what makes something a part of world literature. I'll talk a little bit more about my project as we move along, but as far as the poem we'll be hearing tonight goes, and I'll be doing the recitation after some short remarks, Bekir Shaker Sayyad wrote The Rain Song in the period between 1953 and 1954, and it was first published in the Beiruti literary journal Al-Adad in June 1954, and you have on the slide that issue of that journal. So, for my own research, and particularly for the work I'm doing in the book, this poem comes at a critical moment, because in the timeline that I work with, the US and UK backed a coup against Mohammad Mossadegh in Iran on August 19th, 1953, stands at the center of my timeline. It's at the center of my study. And the book and what I'm doing in the book develops around that moment. This is because I'm also interested in the cultures of the Cold War, the competing cultural programming of Western nations and Soviets and other things like that. So this poem, Unschuldige Mutter, coming out in 1954, develops out of this broader context, one that's also shaped by decolonialism, the rise of nation states, and the rest of the events that came in the wake of World War II. Now, I'm not going to spend too much time on this broader political context tonight, so you'll have to look forward to my book to get the rest of this sort of framing. Inshallah, that will happen in the next couple of years. Instead of talking about this contextual stuff, what I'm going to do for the next 20 or 25 minutes or so is give us some more background about Sayyad and his life, at least as much as I can, and that which I know about, before moving into a more detailed discussion of the poem and some of the formal elements and images that we're going to hear during the recitation. Badr-Shakr Sayyad was born in 1926 in a village named Jaipur, along the banks of a small rivulet called Buwain. The closest city to Jaipur in Iraq is Basra, and that's where you can today find a statue celebrating Sayyad, the poet standing on the Shatt of Arab, that is, the confluence of the Tigris and Euphrates rivers in Basra. But even closer to Jaipur than Basra is the Iraqi-Iranian border and the Iranian city of Khorramshahr, or Al-Muhammara in Arabic. And you can see this on the screenshot I've got from wonderful Google Maps up here. Now, it's this fact, this closeness to Iran, of Sayyad's hometown, that got me thinking about how cross-linguistic poetic exchanges between Arabic and Persian may have played a bigger part in the development of modernist poetry in both traditions than we've previously acknowledged. And that close Iranian border played an important role in Sayyad's life too, since he spent some time in Iran during the 1950s as well. Sayyad lived a troubled life, starting with the death of his mother when he was six. And we're going to see some autobiographical gestures in the poem this evening. For instance, if you look to your handout, thanks again, Abhi, for these wonderful handouts. If you look to your handout and consider lines 24 through 27, and they're also up here on the slide for us, here we have the persona telling us, as though a child rambled deliriously before he went to sleep, that his mother, when he woke a year ago, he couldn't find her. Then, when he kept on asking about her, they told him, she'll be back the day after tomorrow. She must come back. So in these lines, we find Sayyad combining the personal tragedy of his mother's death with what I consider the key theme of modernist poetry in Arabic from this period, intertextual references to myths of death and rebirth. Myths we find across the whole of the modernist movement across the planet. So, along with many, many scholars who have written about Arabic poetry from this time, we might here be thinking of T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland, which also circles around this core theme of death and rebirth. In fact, I think we could go so far as to say that the poem we'll hear tonight might productively be understood as the Arabic Wasteland, though, and I want to highlight this, I should also be very clear that I think making Western modernism the touchstone for Arabic or other modernisms from the global south could do a disservice to other intercultural transactions that may have been more important for the developments of global modernisms. And this is something that I deal with more in my book by looking to Persian modernist poetry and how it was closely connected to Arabic modernist poetry, maybe even more so than either movement was connected to Western modernism. And this happens in terms of both form and theme, which, while that are certainly connected to Western modernism seem to develop in their own ways between Arabic and Persian across these two linguistic contexts. Still, we have to admit that Western modernism did have a lot of influence. For instance, it's been fairly well established that right around the time, say I was writing the Rain Song, he was also reading James Frazer's Golden Bough from 1890 originally. And Eliot had also been reading this when he was writing The Wasteland. It's where he became familiar with ancient Near Eastern myths of death and rebirth, myths like that of the god Tammuz, who's also often called Adonis. And we're going to come back to Adonis in a second. So on the slide here, I have Jabra Ibrahim Jabra's translation of part of the Golden Bough into Arabic. So this is Adonis al-Tammuz. It has a wonderful, colorful cover. And we have some evidence that right around the time Zayab was writing the Rain Song, he was also becoming familiar with the Golden Bough, possibly through Jabra's translation, which we have some evidence that he read. So Ibrahim Jabra, being a Palestinian intellectual, was exiled in Iraq and was part of the literary community there throughout the entire second half of the 20th century, friends with Zayab. But to come back to this name Adonis, some of you, students of Arabic or appreciators of Arab culture, may be familiar with another famous Arab modernist, Ali Ahmed Said Isbar, who goes by the pen name Adonis. Now, while Adonis might now be far more well known than Zayab, he has in the past written about how influential Zayab's work was for his own poetry. In fact, in a 1967 collection of Zayab's poetry that Adonis himself put together, he was sure to include the poem we'll hear tonight, The Rain Song, which I've marked in yellow on the slide there for you, along with many other Zayab's poems that Adonis felt were foundational for Arabic modernism. But if Zayab was born in 1926, why was it up to Adonis to put together a collection of his poems in 1967? Not that long after, right? Now, we come to the other tragic ending of Zayab's short life. His 1964 death from Lou Gehrig's disease, which ravaged his body during the late 1950s and early 1960s. Even though his life was cut short too soon, Zayab left a lasting legacy within the Arabic modernist poetic movement. And who knows what the Arabic poetic scene would look like today had Zayab lived through the end of the millennium. His groundbreaking thematic engagements not only moved back into the ancient Near East with the Tammuz myth, but also included elements of religious syncretism, something we find with his frequent invocations of Christ. For instance, in his poem, Al-Masih Ba'd al-Sal, Christ after the crucifixion. On the other hand, Zayab also cultivated anti-colonial themes, which he grounded in a specifically Islamic context in poems like 1950's Fajr al-Salam, The Dawn of Peace, or 1956's Fil Maghrib al-Arabi, in the Arab Maghreb, about the Algerian War of Independence. But to now move away from Zayab's poetic themes, perhaps the most lasting innovations he pioneered in Arabic poetry have to do with form. And we find some of his earliest published works with these new forms in his 1947 collection, Azhar Dabila, here on the slide for you. That's wilted flowers in English. Zayab's formal experiments played an instrumental part in changing the shape of the Arabic qasida, that is, the ode or long poem. But these formal experiments also retain many elements of pre-modern prosody and rhyme, and they thus link Arabic poetic modernism with the language's poetic heritage.
And I should also mention quickly here that both Sayyad and his Iraqi compatriot, Nazik Malaka, who you all, if you come in a few weeks, you'll be hearing about, they both have a claim to writing the first Arabic poem in free verse. Sayyad's 1947, Hal Kana Hubban, Was It Love, or Malaika's Cholera, from that same year, both based their lines on the poetic foot, rather than the two-hemistich standard of the pre-modern Qasida. So for those of you unfamiliar with Arabic metrics, I don't want us to get into too detailed a discussion of these formal elements, but I do want us to see a little bit how Arabic free verse forms work in the Rain Song itself. Now, I've been putting free verse in scare quotes, you probably noticed, and I'm doing this because Arabic free verse isn't all that free. In fact, during the early development of free verse in the late 1940s, Iraqi poets maintained several elements of earlier verse standards, standards that go back more than 1,000 years. So, while they changed the way poetry looks on the page, and if you look at the poetry on this page and are familiar with pre-modern Arabic poetry, you'll see that it is different. While they changed the way poetry looks on the page, many features of the sound stayed the same. And I think it's important to highlight this retention of earlier verse forms, whereas many scholars writing in the 20th century tended to cast the modernist movement as a radical break with the past. And we find the same thing with Persian modernist poetry. Now, the Rain Song that we'll be hearing today is, in fact, based on a pre-modern metrical pattern called the Rajas, a term that gets translated lots of different ways in English. William Wright, the English Orientalist who died in 1889 and who put out a thorough grammar of the Arabic language in English, calls it the trembling meter. Whereas Edward Lane, who we have here, in his magnificent dictionary, which he never depleted, writes that the Rejez is, and this is Lane, a meter easy to the ear and impressive to the mind. Wherefore, it may be reduced to a single hemistich, and also to 2 feet instead of 6, so called because it commences with a motion and a quiescence. That is a movement and a quiescent letter. Doesn't explain it much better. Followed by a motion and a quiescence that's so in the other feet, resembling the Rejez, there's a Rejez, in a she camel, which consists in her quivering or being quiet. So it's quivering and trembling, that's the idea. And also the definition keeps going on and on. He's drawing on several pre-modern Arabic dictionaries here, so he has a lot of material to work with in this entry. But we will leave Edward Blaine for now. So these arrangements of moving or quiet syllables are what differentiate Arabic meters from each other. And the science of prosody that explains them goes all the way back to the 8th century, when grammarian and prosodist Al-Khalil ibn Ahmed al-Farahidi came up with a method for classifying the already extant Arabic meters in use at the time. And this is from the entry in Arud, or prosody, from the Encyclopedia of Islam, second edition, which if you have access to and are interested in this, this Arud entry is an excellent introduction to how metrics work in Arabic. So Al-Khalil analyzed 15 different meters when he went about this classification system. And a student of his called Al-Akhfash al-Awsat added a 16th later on. These 16 meters remain the basis of modernist Arabic poetry, but what Sayyad and the other modernists, primary among them Nazik al-Malaka, did was to base their poetry on a single foot rather than an entire poetic line. Now, there were lots of rules about how to do this, probably best explained by Malaika in her poetic criticism and found in the book Qadaya Ishir al-Mu'asir, or Issues in Contemporary Poetry, first published in 1962. There, and in her own free verse poetry, she claimed that Arab poets should only use pre-modernity for meters in which there was no variation of the foot across the line. So I have an example here from our slide. We have the tawil there at the top, the long meter, that is. This, according to Madaka, would not be appropriate for free verse poetry because it alternates poetic feet. And I think you'll notice what I mean by these two different feet if I recite them as an Arab prosodist would. So you can follow along here if you like at the top line on the slide. Fa'ulun, foot one. Mefa'ilun, foot two. Fa'ulun, mefa'ilun. Fa'ulun, mefa'ilun, and so on. So this would not work for Manetica. She instead believed, for possibly pedantic or maybe nationalist reasons, and perhaps Professor Drumsa will explain more of this in a few weeks if you are interested, Manetica believed that only meters that had the same foot throughout should be used. Meters like the canon, which you'll also find on the chart here, that means the complete meter, the mutaqarrib, the tripping meter, or indeed the rajas that we are working with this evening. So for our purposes tonight, we are dealing with the rajas, which is based off of the foot mustafar, or if we want to put this in English, scansion, which I'm a little more familiar with myself, we would say it's a long, long, short, long foot. Those are the syllables, right? We have a long syllable, short syllable, long syllable. And if you look at the slide here, you can see how Sayyad bases the meter of the Rain Song, a modernist poem, off of this foot. So I have the first two lines from the poem up here on the slide. And I'll recite them and then give you their metrical form. عيناكي غابتان خيل ساعة الصحر أو شرفتان راح ينهى عقم القمر. So in metrical form, using the Arab prosodic system to represent the feet of these lines, we have مستفعلون 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 فعو مستفعلون 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 فعو. So you can see here that we do have some variations in the feet, especially in this last two-syllable foot there at the end, فعو. And prosodists do disagree over what Arabic foot this should actually be represented by. But this isn't so important for us tonight because I mainly just want us to notice the balance between the first two lines here and how the basal pre-modern foot of Mustafa'ilun provides the core of this poem's metrics throughout. Now, we can dig into how these formal elements work a little more by taking a look here in lines 17 and 18, which are also on your handout. Sayyad here enjams the line so that our active noun comes in the line following the verb. And this line goes, وَدَغْدَغَتْ صَمْتَ صَفِيرٍ عَلَى شَجَرٍ مُشُودَةُ الْمَطَرِ. So for those of you that don't know Arabic, Sayyad has taken مُشُودَةُ الْمَطَرِ, or hymn of the rain, and put it in the line following the verb, دَغْدَغَتْ, which is what we started out with. And in Terry DeYoung's wonderful translation that I've used also on your handout, she translates this as tickle. That's our verb here. Now, what Sayyad is doing is really a break with what we would usually find in a poem with fully pre-modern form, because generally, each line ought to be self-contained. And scholars have made various arguments about why this might be. Here, however, Sayyad spans the image across two separate lines with this lovely enjambment, after which he takes advantage of modernist poetry's ability to repeat a poetic foot a number of times. So here we find one of many instances in the poem, matar, matar, matar. This short, long, short, long, short, long does two things for us. First, it links back to a rhyme on ra or r in English, And if we go back to the first line, we find it there with Sahar, then again later in Qamar, Nahar, Sahar again, Qamar again, and Shajar. So here too, we've got a break with past poetic norms because it was generally considered bad form to repeat a rhyme word in the traditional qasida. And you will see how many times Sayyab repeats the word matar throughout this poem, which was about matar. I don't know, maybe we need to perhaps practice matar for those of us that aren't Arabic speakers. Matar.
Matar. Oh,
wonderful. Okay, so maybe when I get there in the recitation, matar, and you all can join me through subsequent matars. I think that's easy enough that we can all do it, even if we don't know about it. Now, Sayyab really is doing something different here, because the ra on these words really stands out with the repeated word for wings. This is connecting that word together throughout the poem, and Sayyab is also presenting the actual sound of rain pitter pattering throughout the poem. Matar, matar, matar. This sounds like rain to us. And this formal feature of the poem here combines with the verb dahdaha. Dahdaha is one of those wonderful onomatopoeic Arabic verbs with a doubled root. So we see the root letters doubled there. And that means it's actually meant to sound as a word, like tickling does as an action. Now, because Sayyab retains the idrajized meter, we actually hear the song of the rain tickling the silence of the birds and the trees in this line. Some other images that stand out in this poem are, of course, the description of the beloved's eyes in the early lines, which starts us into a series of dichotomies emanating out of these eyes. We first move to a river, fresh water, then almost immediately to the sea, salt water. And I can mention that Terry DeYoung does a lot with this salt water, fresh water dichotomy in her very convincing reading of this poem in the article cited at the end of your handout. Next in the poem, we see the progression of the seasons, but Sayyab plays with these two as any good modernist would, describing the warmth of winter and the shiver of autumn, thus showing us how death and life always remain interconnected somehow. And he has the line here, death and birth, darkness and light. And then, suddenly, we're back to salty tears, dripping down like drops of rain. And as a personal aside on this, when I first read this poem, it seems to me that the way Sayyab treats tears throughout